we're particularly happy to have some friends from a group called Gloucester Innovations, who clearly have some dog and pony show stuff for us. The whole DIY movement, the makerspace movement that then meets Gloucester, and the need for cost-effective, accessible ocean sensing devices is something that they and we think is a really ripe area for this particular community, based on the abilities and skill sets in this community, based on the intellectual capital, based on the need for better and more scientific information about what's going on in our harbor and the ocean. This is just a really exciting area. So I am going to turn it over to Tom and Todd and Mark, and let them give you a sense of what they're thinking about and what sort of great stuff is happening. So,
as Tom said, we're part of a startup called Gloucester Innovation, located here in Gloucester. We have three of us here tonight, sort of the Gloucester contingent. There are a few other people scattered around the country. And Rick Upton, who is the founder, couldn't be here. He's traveling this evening. But we sort of banded together. And in fact, I want to thank Tom or whoever came up with the name for this talk, Melanie, because it really seemed apt for what we wanted to talk about, cool machines. When I think about what we've all been doing over our careers, it's been either building or working with or in some sense interacting with cool machines. I started my career many, many decades ago at the Smithsonian Observatory in Cambridge, designing a control system for the multiple mirror telescope. It was the first multiple mirror telescope ever, and it became sort of the proof of concept for many, many other instruments. But I was recalling earlier just the kinds of machines that we had, computers we had in those days. We were on a mini computer, which if some of you remember those things, they were really they were big, bulky. We had all 16 kilowords of memory to program, and we had something called, it was a magnetic tape random access device, which eventually got replaced with, our first hard disk was a 50 megabyte hard disk as big as a washing machine. So, I mean, if nothing else, this is a testament to this astonishing evolution of hardware and software, for that matter. The other interesting toy that we had to play with in those days, when we were, three of us were in a company called TASC, was the Pixar. Pixar, everybody knows them as an animation company, but when they started, they thought their business was going to be making these boxes, which were at least a decade ahead of their time. They were a bare program, but they did astonishing things with pixels in terms of being able to process them and do all kinds of fancy transforms and so on. So, as I say, we've been extremely lucky to sort of work with those kinds of toys. And tonight, you're going to hear three short talks. The first one is going to, since I'm sort of an audio guy these days, I do a lot of recording and work with a lot of different kinds of audio equipment. I have kind of honed in on hydrophones, which are essentially underwater microphones. Maybe you're familiar with them. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about that, as well as a little bit of the history. And then Todd is going to talk about a low-cost ocean drifter called the DriftBot. That's this table over here. And then Mark will finish up with something he's been doing, which is essentially fabricating, it seems like, an entire armada of aquapods, which are, I'll let him tell you about.
Just two.
So I was trying to, thinking about trying to put this in perspective. Hydrophones actually were invented in the 20th century, and when I looked into it a little bit, I was astonished to discover that Ernest Rutherford, who was a very famous physicist, he's the one who discovered the fact that most of the mass in the atom is contained in a nucleus, a very small part of the atom. And so he got a Nobel Prize for that. By the way, his only patent was for a hydrophone. It was an early invention of his, and you know, like a lot of great scientists, they spread their wings. The hydrophones were, in those days, they were very important in the military because submarines, German submarines, both at the end of World War I and World War II, were, you know, devastating the Allied shipping. And so hydrophone, there were all kinds of schemes for deploying and listening to hydrophones. And then one of the interesting sort of anecdotes about all of this is that one of the problems in recognizing which, whether you had a friendly or a foe submarine was the frequency signature. It turns out that the German submarines had a very high frequency component, up around 15 kilohertz. And in those days, there was no way to record that signal. So Arthur Hattie was this here. Was an engineer at what became Decca Records. If any of you remember Decca, made a lot of very wonderful classical. Well, in those days, classical recording was limited to about 8 kilohertz, which is pretty low, but that was the state of the art. He came up with a scheme that increased that frequency range to 16 kilohertz, and thus they were able to make records of recordings of these of German submarines so that when they would bomb the submarines, they would bomb the enemy as opposed to the friendlies. Later, and by the way, so later in that century, the U.S. deployed what's called the SOSIS hydrophone network. It's a really quite an amazing achievement. These are hydrophones that were distributed originally in the Atlantic and I think later in the Pacific. They're tethered with cables that go all the way back to the mainland. And they were deployed in a way to listen for Soviet submarines. So as you see, a lot of this was driven by DoD-type considerations. But one of the interesting things about what they learned is that there were all these strange sounds that they were recording when they weren't detecting submarines. It turned out to be various kinds of fish, whales, and so forth. The first time I think those things were ever heard was in some of these networks. But the data was classified, which made it hard to share. I think ultimately it got declassified, and the data is now somewhat available. Satellite remote sensing, which I won't say much about, was also another big change in the latter part of the 20th century. It changed the way not only we look at the Earth, but how we look at the oceans. And so. Now, the 21st century is quite different. It's being driven not by DoD considerations, but by entrepreneurs and citizen scientists. There's still the big programs. NOAA has a lot of very large scope programs, but there are new and affordable sensors of both imaging, acoustic, chemical sensors that are available and affordable. And you can craft them together into some kind of a vehicle. You can collect data. You can get the data sent through a network to a base station. And so really, it's astonishing what's happening in terms of new technology and affordable technology. A really interesting example is something called the wave glider. This was an invention of a group in Hawaii. The idea was to invent, I mean, one of the big problems with any kind of robot is power. You know, you have batteries and you have motors. Batteries run down. It's usually not possible to charge them with solar cells quickly enough. Anyway, these guys came up with the idea of transferring wave energy, so up and down motion, into glider motion. So there's something on top which bobs up and down with the waves. And then these fins or wings force the device to translate in a particular direction. And you can put a rudder on it and some electronics, so you can have it go wherever you want. And station key, I think one has even gone all the way across the Pacific. So it's a I would say it's a good thing to Google and watch. It's really quite an inspiring story. You're going to hear about DriftBot and Aquapod later. This is the other local story, which maybe some of you are aware of, the SnotBot, that was a Kickstarter, and that's another very interesting device, essentially using a drone to fly through the sputum of a whale, collect it, and then bring it back for analysis. Now, one of the things that maybe you didn't know is that fish do make sounds. They don't make a lot of sound, they don't vocalize all the time, but they do make sounds. So for example, that's the sound that a haddock makes. It's kind of a not a very impressive sound, but that thumping. Perch. Sea urchin, it's kind of a clicking sound. And then of course you're familiar with various kinds of blue whales. Here's the blue whale, it's quite impressive. Signals is potentially disturbing to wildlife, and in any case, you're doing something that they don't normally experience. So, listening with passive hydrophones lets you, you know, sort of study the actual, the normal behavior of the mammals or fish that you're interested in. It can also be used for location and tracking, and so, for example, in addition to audio, being able to support things like oil and gas deposits, finding those, locating them, you can also locate and track fish and mammals, such as whales, that's been demonstrated. Potentially monitor fisheries for spawning behavior, for example. Also, one of the research areas is trying to estimate the abundance of cetaceans or fish species. And then finally measuring the plankton biomass. I saw a paper about that recently. So these are interesting ways that one can use acoustics. Now they're just to distinguish microphones from hydrophones. On the left here is a microphone, this one in fact. Notice that it's open, so there's a diaphragm. You can kind of see the diaphragm through the grill. That's because the air, the waves that are passing through the air have to hit the diaphragm, which vibrates, which results in a voltage, which you can sense, and then turn into a signal. So, you know, microphones are sensitive to,
obviously,
if you blow on them, you get wind noise, which is not a good thing if you're trying to record something, but that's the violent interaction of the wind with the diaphragm. This is a hydrophone. This is a fairly inexpensive one. This is about $100, something like that. But it's quite sensitive. Notice when I talk at it, though, nothing happens. It doesn't pick up my voice, but it is very sensitive to handling. This is because it's using the mechanism is called piezoelectricity, which essentially is the certain materials are sensitive to when a pressure is applied, they create an electrical voltage, and again you can turn that into a signal. So this is an example. If I drop it in a suddenly it becomes alive, so it's able to, oh, by the way, the feedback, you don't get feedback unless you do this, because it's actually picking up the vibrations, you know, in the room, through the table, and then, so, okay, let's see. So, if you happen to have a couple of microphones and a couple of hydrophones, you can do a very simple experiment, which is measure the speed of sound in air and water, which I did. So, this first chart here was, I created this by just using a metronome and recording the pulses and measuring the delay between two pulses, given knowing the time between the pulses. This one was a little bit trickier because I didn't have hydrophones handy at the time, so I was using an old recording that I made for Mark, which was essentially moving a wand around a couple of hydrophones. And but in any case, I was able to get a similar kind of measurement. And so these were the measured results. Air was about 1.19 feet per millisecond, and water was about 4.7, 4.8. It's about 4.3 times faster. And the reason for that is water is much denser, and so the sound travels more quickly through it. Now, I want to show you something, which is these, by the way, these are called spectrograms. So what you see down here along this axis is time. Along this axis is frequency. So you'll see in a minute when I show you one being built up in real time, you'll see that it sort of moves from left to right. As you move up this way, you get to higher and higher frequencies. This is low frequency, high frequency. And then the brightness corresponds to how loud the signal is. Okay, so let me just bring this here. So here's a first one of these is a multi-track recording of some humpbacks. And as we bring this up, this is actually the spectrogram being built up in real time. See the vocalizations. And if I look at the sort of frequencies correspond in this region, it's kind of capping out around 6 kilohertz or so. So it's in the normal human hearing range for this kind of vocalization. However, if you move to another, let's see if we can find it here. The next one would be a sperm whale doing echolocation. So sperm whales, like bats, emit these very high frequency clicks. And they use that, they use the return pulse to sense their environment. The high frequency information is much more amenable to detecting objects and shapes and so on. And you can see that the frequencies here correspond to, this is much closer to around 20 kilohertz, much, much higher.
Was that each of those ticks, was that the natural course that they send those ticks out then?
Yes.
Huh, curious.
As far as I know, that was a recording that was actually given to us by a researcher, so I'm assuming that they didn't do any speeding up.
Had that been adjusted to bring the frequency up to be audible by humans? Or is that the frequency that...
Well, I mean, so those clicks, actually part of it was in the regime we can hear.
I see.
The part that I was, you know, the very highest frequencies, maybe some of you can hear that high, I can't anymore. But boring than that. Some of the hydrophones for studying certain kinds of whale vocalizations need to be, you know, 100 kilohertz or more. I mean, they're really quite astonishing. Okay. So what's next? Well, I don't know. I mean, we're in the process of, you'll hear kind of what's coming, what we've been working on. I think this summer we hope to actually deploy multiple hydrophones and do some, some people call it triangulation. It's actually trilateration, which is essentially a way of looking or homing in on the locations of whales or other targets. And we have enough hydrophones now that we can do some of those experiments.
So I'm sort of I've been a lifelong nerd. When I was a kid, I did ham radio. You know, some of the stuff Tom was talking about in terms of what computer technology looked like 4 years ago. I've had the privilege, I guess, of sort of being able to track that over my career. And now here where I am in my career, I've decided to sort of explore and understand, well, what can you do now on the cheap? And about a year ago, we all got together and tried to think of stuff to do, stuff that was fun and interesting and really helpful. I had a keen interest in, you know, get kids to get into this stuff, as I did as a kid. And it was different 40-some-odd years ago, or actually 50-some-odd years ago. But it's actually a lot easier, and it's a lot cheaper, and it's sort of the intellectual process that I wish I could have explored at length 50 years ago. And a lot of this is now referred to as sort of a maker space or the maker head. You know, how do you put things together yourself? It's actually gotten pretty hard. Back in when I was a kid, you'd go to Radio Shack, which was prolific. There was one on every corner, not so much after Chapter 11. I grew up in New York City, and on 45th Street between 5th and 6th Avenue was maybe a dozen stores that sold things. The weirdest things, you know, gyroscopes. So it was just, one, take the subway down and spend 3 hours kind of moving around. If you want to make something, you either have to have large milling machines or expensive, heavy sort of stuff that as a 15-year-old, 14-year-old, I didn't have. Most everything you could easily put together sort of without glasses or without microscopes and soldering irons and things like that. At the time, and Tom alluded to this in terms of mini computers, those things were expensive. They were big, they were power hungry. And the thought of actually sort of telecommunicating from one computer or another was difficult. And typically involved really fat wires that you had to string between machines. If you were Noah 40 years ago, you designed experiments that cost $1 million to put in the water, and they weren't that interesting. And generally they had lots of wires. Well, what does it look like today? Today you can buy anything on eBay or Amazon. There are some specialty online vendors who have lots of stuff that is remarkably cheap. And I think, in large part, due to this technology, extremely powerful and cheap and small and power-sipping. They're not very big things. From a laptop, you can sort of create a 3D model of something, send it off, and somebody sends you something back, and it might cost you $50. And that can be, you know, machined aluminum, it can be 3D printing, which you may have heard about. It can also be circuit boards, where I can design a printed circuit board on a laptop that has multiple layers of copper that interconnects pins that components fit into. And 3 days later, you get three of these for $50, three copies for $50. It's insanely cheap. The cell phone world has sort of resulted in just ridiculously powerful machines, at least by my 15-year-old status, that cost nothing or are extremely cheap. We'll go into some of that in a second. And again, I think mostly because of cell phone technology, things like GPS, accelerometers, magnetometers, temperature gauges, lots of sensors are now these little things, which unfortunately, even with heavy glasses and maybe a microscope, I could attempt to assemble with a sonogram. But typically, if you look at what's inside some of these things, you quickly realize they're all machine assembled. You know, these robotic things that place parts, solder parts, and it's done, and it does 10 a minute. So given the nerd as a kid, nerd as a 60-year-old, and the desire to do STEM, sort of help kids engage in science, as I tried to do when I was a kid, we all got together and connected with Ian Kerr of the Ocean Alliance, who at the time wanted to detect plastics in the ocean. It seemed like the perfect vehicle without any clear, what is it really supposed to do, for me to just start futzing around. And this is actually the result of some of that futzing around. And the goal was to build something that could drift, report its position, perhaps take pictures or onboard compute, do I see plastic, and then send those results out to, we'll call it a ground station, which is typically a term used for things that are in orbit. But same concept. How can I bring all this data back? And if I had 100 of these floating around, where do I see plastic? And again, with the STEM, science, technology, engineering, math, educational component, can you do this on the cheap for under $1,000? And so I started trying to build something. Just a quick thing, we talked a little bit about this already, cell phones being sort of the driving force behind. Moore's law is this thing that says basically every year or every hunk of time, things become half price, twice as fast, and can store twice as much. It's, you know, it's what we've all experienced if we have any kind of computer stuff in computer history. It's just insane how this stuff has grown. But I think because of cell phones, the drive to make it battery powered, to make it low power consumption, really compact, has totally accelerated. There are big computers still today, but I think we sort of summed up all the compute power in the world, half of it might be on things like cell phones. And so I wanted to talk about sort of just very high level survey kind of thing of what's available, what's out there. So an educator in the UK, at Oxford, I believe, wanted to provide his students and other students really inexpensive computer. He designed this. And what's on here looks to be very few books. Small parts, I'll pass it around. I'm not too worried about if someone steals it because it's only cost $35. But on there is a Broadcom chip, which is a computer, it has memory, it has basically it's what's in your cell phone to do all the computing. And it's called a system on a chip. It's not just a CPU that Intel might make. It has all this other stuff embedded on it. The stuff that's embedded on it, whiz to here, is basically a quad-core processor that runs at 900 megahertz. If you've been to Best Buy and tried to buy a machine, a PC or a Mac or something, those aren't the world's best specs, but they're interesting. Again, $35. It has a gigabyte of RAM. It has four USB ports, which you'd be familiar to if you pass that around. It has lots of GPI, general purpose I/O pins, things that go up and down, 0 and 1, 0 and 1, and connect things to it. It has HDMI video output, that's what your flat screen TV on the wall connects to your cable box with. It has an Ethernet port, it does audio, it has a camera interface. And basically all the memory on it, all the storage, what would normally be a disk drive on a computer, is on a micro SD card, which you can now edit. And it runs the Unix operating system, the Linux operating system. Just as an example, this has one of those on it. And hopefully this won't burn me in a demo hell. But I'm plugging it into a battery, and nothing happens. So, 7-inch display, $60, $35. So, I mean, it's more expensive than an Android tablet. But here it's booting up, it's sort of doing all the things. You know, I gotta get ready to do something kind of thing. It has a Wi-Fi dongle on it, which is talking to my cell phone and my iPhone. And if all goes well, we'll boot an operating system where I can web browse. If I've actually connected it, you know what, I'm not gonna go through it, but basically, a full up computer, $100, and you can put it together without a solder gun. That's very interesting. That allows sort of the geeks among us to write code and do image processing and detection algorithms, listen to things. But there's another part of the goal that says I want to be able to sense temperature, voltages, current. Maybe we'll see in a second, there's some weird devices that are out here now. And so it turns out there's another device that you probably want to use, and it's this. This is another computer, but it's called an Arduino. It's actually designed in Italy. And it comes in a million different places. It's $25. I'll pass this around. But what's on here is lots of input-output capability. It has six channels where I can measure a voltage between 0 and 5 volts. So if I have a sensor that sort of outputs voltage related to some parameter, I can measure it. It has very little memory, only 32 kilobytes of memory, and it runs at a very slow speed, 16 megahertz. If you marry those two together with a whole bunch of sensors, and here's sort of another interesting survey, in here is all everything I've talked about, and this as well. An inertial measurement unit, which is basically something that says, if I'm here, and I'm in an airplane, and I'm rolling or pitching, can I measure that? In the old days, there were gyroscopes, and then there became ring laser gyros, which are very accurate. All very, very expensive, and mostly mechanical, some of them mechanical. But now, on this little board, there's a chip that basically senses all that. And it just streams it out as numbers. There are temperature sensors. There's something that allows you to measure the current flowing through a circuit. In the lower left is a full-up GPS receiver. Here's one up here. There are things that are like just a bunch of wire with a bulb on the end, and it measures temperature and outputs it as numeric numbers, not voltages or just, you know, the temperature is, da-da-da-da. And you see price tags all in here. You can sort of do a little mental math and say, all right, so far we're not too expensive. But how do you communicate? If this thing is drifting out of the ocean, how does it get data back to you? Today, and the nightmare I'm having at the moment is there's a little Wi-Fi thing that's plugged in the USB port here, and I've lost connection, so I can't talk to this. There are now, thanks to cell phone technology, little devices, which is about the size of a business card, that are full up 4G, 3G or 4G modems. So there's one in here that talks to Verizon, and basically I can turn it on and say, pretend I'm disconnecting to...
Good luck with Verizon.
Well, I have to make a choice. I don't know if there's a
reason.
But if it's out in the water, so how far offshore can I really do that? It has funky antennas. Don't look like your cell phone antennas. It's part of the diversity antenna system. So it's actually a tuner that does something a little better than what's inside your cell phone. There's satellite communications, which is very expensive. It's very power hungry. But clearly, that's something that can work worldwide. So in a world where there are things floating around, you sort of have to make a choice of how you're going to talk, how you're going to communicate, and how far offshore are you. Wi-Fi certainly isn't going to work. I'm a sailor. I check into a yacht club. And yeah, there's a Wi-Fi thing over there. And maybe you can get it 150 feet away or whatever. The sort of cellular modem technology, 10 miles offshore. Not perfect, but interesting. And the satellites are certainly worldwide, but again, expensive. So I started building all this, and I mentioned nerd as a kid, ham radio. I was very concerned that if and when I ever got this thing floating, it would get lost. And how could I find it? If it's unable to communicate back, as it turns out, there's something in ham radio called the automatic packet reporting system. And I sailed from Manchester by the seat back to Boston last spring, and I had this device lower right in the corner with me. And basically, it's just a beacon. It's a VHF beacon, which is sort of the same frequency that radio communications in the sea are done by. And it has a GPS receiver, and it basically says, I'm here, I'm here, I'm here, I'm here, I'm here, at regular intervals. And this is the day when I was sailing these winds, and you can see me tapping back and forth a whole bunch. But there are stations, a lot on Cape Man, ham radio stations, upper right in the corner, and there's one off here in that's apparently on one of those TV towers, wall ham, and it has great coverage. So it actually heard me all the way from the Hunt back into the Boston train. So the thought was, I'd have this also on board, just in case I got lost, and I could get it above the there. So I started again about a year ago, and 9 months ago, I started to design some things, did it with a CAD system. The goal for the plastic detection initially was to have something about a meter under the surface, where one illuminates that volume of water with ultraviolet light, plastics will fluoresce. And if you had a camera below, you might see them. Haven't gotten there yet. Mark's done some experiments there, and it wasn't that promising, so I'm not clear where I should go there around. But basically, a top deck with a 21-inch diameter dome, inside of which is this. This is a solar panel on top. It has a charge controller. It's an 18-amp-hour battery, charging this all the time. In here are temperature sensors, the inertial measurement units, measure sort of wave action, GPS receiver, and a camera, 5-megapixel camera, connected to that Raspberry Pi that's hopefully still floating around, on two servos. So I can position the camera this way, that way, essentially in 360 as an operation store, and take pictures. The 3G modems below, flotation. The lower deck basically has a smaller plastic dome with a Raspberry Pi and a camera, and talks to the upper deck and can actually broadcast out. So here's what got built. It hasn't changed much. This is the end of August or so. But basically, the most expensive things here were these large aluminum plates, about 150 bucks each, 3/8 inch thick, 2 foot by 2 foot. And what I discovered, and thankfully I put a temperature sensor in here, is that as I was very interested into, you know, how well does this solar panel charge this battery? And could I leave it running for, how long would it run before it ran out of juice? And what I discovered was, with the dome, in bright sunlight, I could measure the temperature inside, and it got up to about 150 degrees, at which point I decided, all right, unplug, I gotta do something different here. The sun was just baking everything inside. And here we see sort of the innards of what's underneath the solar panel. Won't go into great detail here. The heat buildup problem seals. I'm not a marine engineer. I don't know how to sort of make that work really well. I was very concerned about leakage. Buoyancy calibration, how much flotation material do I have to put underneath that top plate to actually keep it above the surface? How to sort of maintain integrity of all the through-hole connections, and how to get these up as high as possible so that Verizon might have some chance of hitting it. I was going to do a demo. I'm not, because I've lost sort of this guy's ability to go to Wi-Fi around, so I'll stop there. It's a it's actually been enormously fun. This stuff is so easy Admittedly, I've got a computer science background, so sort of the programming part is pretty straightforward. But it's just so much fun to be able to put stuff together that does things at relatively cheap cost. So I'll stop there and do that.
So I moved here about 13 years ago, and in my free time, I've been pretty much lost in the woods most of that time. And someone said to me about a year ago, you know, we're surrounded by all this water, you know, there's water on Gloucester, maybe you should get interested in like that, as opposed to, you know, Dogtown and the quarries and so on, which seemed reasonable. So I met... I can only do one thing at a time. So, hooked up with these guys, and my background's in aerospace, and so my interest was, okay, you know a lot about sensing the Earth from space. I wonder if you could use a lot of those same technologies, you know, with the Maker and assistant science kind of spin to do ocean sensing low cost and do it in a way, do stuff that's really relevant to Gloucester. So I thought to myself, well, what's the easiest way to be a citizen scientist? Well, everyone's got a mobile device. Actually, I don't have mine right now. It's downstairs. But usually we're inseparable, right? And mobile devices are computers, sensors, network connectivity, like we were talking about, like pretty amazing devices. And these devices potentially, if you think about it, could be used to collect, analyze, and share scientific data. Most people don't do that. Most people are doing Facebook or gaming and stuff. But, you know, the nerds out there could be doing, you know, science with it. So, what's the easiest way of getting an iPhone into the water? Well, you could just drop it in, but you know, it's not recommended. Blue Robotics is a company that sells these watertight enclosures. And so what I thought to do last summer was to marry an iPhone into a watertight container, and I call it an aquapod. And that's what we see. I'll walk over here. I have one here. I could pass it around, but it's pretty heavy. It's a lot heavier than the Raspberry Pi. And, you know, I'll leave it up here and you take a look at it later. I actually have another one downstairs in one of the tanks. I'll talk about that in a bit. So what is it? It's a device that is intended to collect data. You deploy it and you retrieve it. It's autonomous. It operates automatically. It uses, you can record audio, video, and potentially you can have other sensors with apps that can collect, that can be used to customize, you know, marine data collection, do time lapse, and I'll show you examples of these things. But besides an iPhone, you could put a Raspberry Pi, as Todd showed you. In fact, I have one down in the tank, and it's still running. So serving as a webcam and sending pictures of fish up to the internet and to a website that we can take a look at. So you can, you know, put an iPhone, a Raspberry Pi, some cute technology called Little Bits, which Rick Upton, our founder, was suggesting maybe we do an aquapod with these. They're like snap together components, which is even probably more modular and easier to use than the Raspberry Pi. It's just getting simpler and simpler. Anyway, the idea is that when you have this container, you can put all kinds of stuff into it, and you can do it at a fairly low cost. So the experiments I started doing last summer, this is at Flat Rocks up in Lanesville, and I built a simple device here. It wasn't very elegant. I learned a lot about flotation, that you need a lot of weight to sink this thing, because it's filled with air. So I just kept adding more and more cement board until it was sunk. I finally got it down there. I paddled out with a boogie board and put it in the water for about 8 hours, collected some data. behind this was to do plastics detection. Tom referred to Ian Keir at Ocean Alliance. So one of the experiments I thought I'd do is to try to image plastic floating in the ocean. And these are some images, actually these are from a movie, from movies. But this is a plastic filament over here and some other pieces of plastic that are imaged with a macro lens. So you can get a, you know, with your, friends at Prof. With these phones, you can actually get clip-on lenses that serve as macro lenses so you can see things really close up, kind of like a microscope. And that's what I used here. So these are very tiny objects. In fact, and I'll get to actually that next one in a moment. This is a day in the life at the bottom of Plum Cove. So this is turning on a time-lapse app and putting it in the iPhone, sealing it up, putting it down, and just having it sit there on the bottom all day. And it's fascinating. There's crabs, there's fish. You see the color of the water change as the sun angle changes and as the tide comes in and goes out. We're familiar with the surface of the water, but we don't spend a whole lot of time underneath the water. And it's fascinating. There's all sorts of stuff going on down there. This is a small fish here. You see it? And it's followed by a skate. You can see it moving up there. So, in some cases, you could just use, the camera app that comes with your phone, or in this case, I developed a time-lapse app that is designed to basically work until the phone runs out of power. Most apps, if that happens, the video that you're recording is going to get saved, and you're out of luck. So this app, it could just crash, and then later on, you just recharge the phone, and you get all your pictures and build a time-lapse, and that's why I ran with Plum Cove. So with these phones, you can get clip-on lenses, and you can play games with lighting. So this, I used a macro lens earlier for the plastics, and here I have a macro lens and a UV light source, and this was used to image some very tiny marine organisms that bioflores. In other words, you hit them with one wavelength of light, and they emit light at a different wavelength. And I have some other examples of this, but you can kind of see it. There's a little tail. Again, it's done with an iPhone. So these are just some of the experiments done last summer. So this, I think you got to play with the data. You got to experience the data. That teaches you about the technology, and it's very much an iterative process. So I figured I'd clean up the design. People looked at it and said, "What is that awful thing?" So I cleaned it up a little bit, and so instead, I have some pictures here, but I can just show you. So instead of using cement board, I did something really fancy, and I bought a barbell. It's a cheap way to get of weight, right? So this is a barbell. This is structural aluminum. These are closet flange spacers. Any plumbers here? It works perfectly. It clips. And so if I loosen, and these are stainless steel rods, so if I loosen this up, I will do this, I'll take it out. So this is the device, and this is a power pack. It's a 12 amp hour lithium ion power pack. This is there's the iPhone in there. It's an old iPhone. It's a good way of using your old iPhones. And you probably don't want to put your new one in case any of these things leak up here. This is a vent plug that you need to open up to take this thing apart because it's watertight. And on occasion I had forgotten to put this in and I've gotten things inside wet. So using old phones, if you lose an old phone, it's not as bad as losing your new iPhone 6. Anyway, so that's... And I have another one down in the tank running, and we can take a look at that later.
weatherproof in case those batteries explode?
That's what I'm told. I want to try that experiment. We won't. I mean, I have to do that eventually. So possible deployment configurations. What I've done so far is mooring it at the bottom. Because there you have a stable base for doing time lapse. If things are moving around, it's kind of hard to visually sort of understand what's going on. But another option is to mooring it at depth. So you separate the weight as the anchor, and then this thing floats, you know, some depth. And then another option is to suspend it and tow it from a canoe. It's been one suggestion. From a drip spot, you know. Just getting started, so there's a lot of ideas, a lot of things ahead of us to try. So the starting point was an iPhone, but in many applications, the way to really go is to put a Raspberry Pi in it, because then you can do so much more, and you can interface a lot more sensors, temperature sensors, and other things to it. The iPhone is a nice option for doing, like, recording audio, like hydrophone data. I'll show you an example of that in a bit, or you listen to it in a bit. Or obviously for video, because these are built-in features of an iPhone, so you know, you don't really need to add anything to a Raspberry Pi. But if you're going to start doing temperature sensing and other things, it probably makes sense to look at a Raspberry Pi. But AquaPods would support, you know, either one or little bits potentially as well. This is the device that's found in the tank. There's the Raspberry Pi camera. The Ethernet cable. So this is, you know, you put it down and it's, you got the lines and the float. There's no communication. This actually has an Ethernet and a power cable that would go to either another device like a DriftBot or to a Wi-Fi sitting on a pair. So one idea is to maybe put this in once this site has been remediated to actually do some habitat. I'll get ahead of myself. I'll talk about that in a minute. Sorry. Do you have that web page? I have a Raspberry Pi connected up to a MacBook and my iPhone. I'm using it as a hotspot downstairs, so that's why I don't have my phone. It's in a fish tank. This is actually the first test of it. I just want to make sure we still get the video. My nightmare is that these things, you know, they leak. Right?
Here we are. There's plenty of fish there.
Are there fish in the show? Anyway, if you have a mobile device, you go to intelligentgadgets.us AquaPod simple webcam.html. It's streaming fish.
Everybody go there and try and crash it.
So you know, why is this cool? Well, you know, you can go online and they have webcams at beaches and, you know, all over the place. It's all above water. What's going on underwater? Wouldn't it be great to have networks of underwater cameras that are imaging what's going on underneath? Because we're not familiar with that world. It's a whole universe. So this is where, you know, this aspect of the AquaPod is going. I would like to have it be more, you know, this is sort of one application that's, maybe a little bit more challenging because you need, you know, more infrastructure, you need communications and internet, stuff like that. So besides devices, your algorithms and applications, I'm an algorithm guy, so I like to write code that does things like, like a time-lapse app, I showed you other apps for processing video. Tom and I have been talking about algorithms for processing acoustic data. For some of the applications, why would you do this? Some of the applications, environmental studies, underwater monitoring, virtual reality, being able to come up with sort of immersive experiences for people that, you know, don't normally get below the water. Acoustic detection of marine animals. And acoustical mapping sounds, you know, mapping the distributions of sounds in the harbor, or what does the harbor sound like? So the 3D movie camera app actually allows you to take regular video, and by you know, video is a succession of frames. If something is moving, that's sort of equivalent to, you know, what you see with one eye and another is the same thing, but it's displaced, and that displacement causes a parallax shift. Well, with motion, you get the same sort of effect. So by processing the camera, the video data, in certain ways, you can actually get 3D video free. So these are apps that run in the device. So it's apps, devices, and then what could you do with it? This guy's obviously amazed. I don't know what he's looking at, but it must be. I don't think it's this.
Yeah, maybe it's Martians.
It might be Martians. I don't know if you're able to do it, but if you can look at this, I don't think instructions here, we can maybe do it offline, but there's a way of actually seeing that without glasses. You kind of cross your eyes a little bit. Can you see it? Anyone see that?
It's tricky to do at distance.
And you get too close, if it's too big, it's hard. It's sort of the right distance. But we can look at this more later. I don't want to take too much time. What time is it, actually?
It's just after.
Okay. It's 8:07.
Yes, okay. So, you know, so one thing you could do with this is create these, by putting an aquapod down in some interesting places where there's interesting sea life, you could record some video, and then as part of an exhibit, people could actually look at this, and it would be like they're down there. And they're experiencing. You added the sound, a couple of hydrophones, you get stereo sound. And, you know, again, this is something that we don't normally experience, so to be able to do that using this technology would be cool. Mapping ocean sounds. This project would involve using three aquapods with hydrophones, recording acoustic data that's time synced. That could either be played back as sort of a surround sound kind of experience, or processed using trilateration. This is, Tom referred to that earlier, where you'd actually be able to map the location of sounds on a real-time basis in the harbor. So as a ship is, you know, coming in or going out of the harbor, you'd actually be able to see that in a map. I think this would be kind of a cool thing for kids to be able to do. Maybe it's a little nerdy, I don't know, but it's really experiential because, you know, it's like you're learning about, well, you're experiencing the physics, learning about sound, and you're doing some simple math, you know, triangulation or trilateration. So there's a lot of cool educational elements here. Last week I put the new aquapod in the dock here. And, oh, sorry, I forgot something. I wanted to play this. Can I yeah, audio?
And it's a little, you have to change the.
All right. Actually, I don't have to. You can hear that, right?
Yeah.
Do you know what's going on back here? Well, Tom is going to, I guess, tell you in a couple of weeks, right? Like it's nasty.
It's a secret until then.
This is a pile dryer. I mean, that kind of hurts your ears, even without fancy speakers. That was 20 feet underwater in Niagara. A few days later, put the camera down to record some video. This is off the pier, just to see what it looked like down there. The thought is maybe to take video and sound, we'll take video data during the remediation, and then later on, you know, kind of do a before and after, what it looks like under the surface and back here now and after, you know, 2017, I guess, is when the work will be done. But you got to go through a number of steps to deploy it. And one thing, if you read through this, you have to make sure the ropes are not in front of the camera. I mean, it's simply a matter of turning the thing, right? So, you know, and I did, actually, one of the items on the checklist was making sure the iPhone camera is actually pointing out. This is black acrylic, and if it's pointing the wrong way, it's not going to work. So
it gives you a distance and scale reference. So there's a It could be a van.
That's very good. That's so it was a feature.
Right.
So one idea is to maybe use this to when the work is done and they put the sand and they clean up the area, is to watch the return of the habitat. Mm-hmm. And you know, there's probably other ideas, and over the next few months, you know, really be looking to kind of explore that sort of experiment space to see what other sorts of things that could be done. But the idea here would be to maybe take a picture every day at the same time and do a time lapse over a year. Of course, that's predicated on being able to keep the thing running for a year. So I guess it's still, is that still changing? Has it changed recently? Oh, yeah, there it goes. Good. Okay. It's working. Thank you. So, I mean, for, you know, it's a small step. So anyway, so several new devices are being already being developed and deployed and tested. And expectation is to continue doing this through the summer with these devices. And over this period of time, they should become available for educational projects and other applications. So I want to make a few more of them. And the initial cost is about $500 per unit. But, you know, with economy of scale, as, you know, this is all hand-manufactured and it's pretty laborious, but over time, should be able to make them more cheaply if they turn out to be useful. So, you know, it's an experiment. We'll see. So the other thing is, the only other thing I have to show is a demo down in the tank. I don't know if we want everyone going down the stairs because it's kind of dark, right?
Let me look, and why don't we take, if you're done, take some questions and answers, and we'll check to see.
And we could do that afterwards.
Yeah, and then we could do that afterwards.
Okay. All right. So, do you have any questions?
So, thank you. This is terrific. This was, it's clear that you all are having a lot of fun. And fun is certainly a worthwhile objective, but is there a bigger goal? What are you hoping to interact with students in high school, or make something commercially, or what are you trying to do in the future?
Well, I mean, I think that's part of what the bootstrapping phase that we're in is sort of figuring that out. We've obviously talked with the educational institutions, Endicott College, for example. We've had a lot of interactions there. We may be doing some things with them. We've talked with a number of possible ventures where we might monitor, for example, some sort of fisheries for fisheries health and aquaculture type situations where they need to monitor the health of the crustaceans or whatever it is that they're harvesting. We've been talking with a variety of folks like that and some others. So, but we haven't really picked our space yet. So this is very much building something is the opportunity to sort of get some experience with this domain. You know, building something for marine applications is very different than for a terrestrial application. You have a whole bunch of constraints that make it harder. And I think that learning process, whatever we end up doing, that learning process will.
If I can ask just one follow-up question. My admittedly naive understanding is that deploying sensors in a variety of is a big focus of what goes on at Bliss Hole these days. And so are you interacting with them at all?
We are. We're talking with Bliss Hole folks. We're talking with a number of other research groups. Obviously, we're University of Massachusetts, which is involved in this. Yeah, the idea is to find, some complementary thing to do. And there are citizen science opportunities, which I think is something we are all interested in. Trying to engage all of you to get involved in collecting data, analyzing data, whatever it is, and see if that can then complement some of the big programs that NOAA and some of these other places are involved in.
Thank you.
I would think NOAA, maybe you do these, you know, the whole data, NOAA data fishing business goes on forever. Could you mount these things on some fishing boats and get the data?
Yeah, I've been talking with some fishermen, actually.
Have you been doing that?
Exactly.
Have they thrown you overboard yet?
They're very interested. I mean, you know, the...
I think it would be terrific, yeah.
I mean, one of the things that we looked at early on, and it's a very hard problem, is the decimation of the fish stocks. And why has...
Get the data, yeah.
And some people have said, okay, well, we've had all of these programs cutting the fish catch limits. Why haven't the fish returned? There are a lot of questions. Have they moved on? And so there's a lot we don't know. And
I think there's the opportunity to continuously monitor.
Yeah.
Versus you have to pay it twice a year.
And you don't have to pay a guy on board.
That's
a
great
idea. Yeah, I think it's true.
You mentioned the complementarity thing. So have you looked into, you know, these various research institutions? Obviously, research like this is going on all the time on various scales. So have you found the kind of niche where it is really a place for doing, you know, instead of deploying a few expensive devices for this research stuff, to be able to deploy 1,000 of these quick and dirty things, you know, maybe couple hundred will keep working, and getting a different, you know, scale of data. Have you seen that there's a place for that?
I think we believe there is.
Yeah, I mean, it seems reasonable. Yeah, it's this whole idea of crowdsourcing, which is, you know, kind of a popular notion these days. So if we can make a lot of inexpensive devices, you know, like Tom was saying, you know, right now surveys are done on a very limited basis, both spatially and temporally. Right. Mm. But if you can have a lot of things out there in the ocean that are looking at, you know, over a wide area at lots of different points continuously, then you're going to get a much better estimate. And so, you know, your data may not be as good, you know, in some sense, because you know, there's always that issue of, you know, are you using, you know, professional devices? You know, maybe, you know. It would be, you know, someone looked down on the fact that you're using a low-cost computer. Why use a low-cost computer if you can spend, you know, $1,000 on something, right? Or $10,000. These instruments are really expensive, hundreds of thousands of dollars, some of these instruments. So that's kind of, we sense there's an opportunity there, and we sense that it's good. If we're, you know, obviously we're inspired, and if we can pass that inspiration on to the community here, there's a lot of smart people here. I mean, Gloucester is a perfect place to do this kind of stuff. So that we're kind of excited about that opportunity.
Yeah. It seems like taking us all into consideration, what you're kind of doing is going after the smartphone for underwater sensing. So you're trying to create a device that's sort of universal, that does sensing, data transmission, power generation, motility, and all those kind of basic things, and then let people create apps for it, right? Make them cheap enough. Thousands of them out there. Let people create great apps, and we'll have the next Uber for underwater sensing.
I resonate mostly with that because I'm an app developer, and Todd was the one that actually inspired me to do the Raspberry Pi. And I mean, that's there's such a huge, you know, the sky's the limit with that. Because with an iPhone, obviously you're somewhat limited by the device, by the instrumentality. You can do everything, I mean, infinite stuff with the apps, but you're still limited by the sensors. But with, you know, an Arduino and a Raspberry Pi is kind of talking about some of these sensors, you know, you can do so much more. So I think it's, you know, I don't think we want to be dogmatic. I think we're maybe somewhat, you know, want to be somewhat device agnostic and be open to use whatever works. As long as it's cheap and you can deploy it and it's easy to use and it creates excitement and you know, sort of buy-in, that's kind of what we're trying to do.
I guess I have an observation. I just signed my son up today, he's 11, for an MIT tech camp doing, making something with Arduino, and then there was another Raspberry Pi thing, and then there was making an app for an iPhone or an Android. And I've been thinking a lot about, he's done so many programs here at Maritime Gloucester, and I think the opportunity, you know, he sees outside the box of what I see, and his friends all see outside the box. They just have these observations that we can't really conceive of. And I wonder if you've put it out in front of a bunch of 10 to 18-year-old kids. I mean, my daughter, who's 15, sees the world differently too. And they just think about what you could do with this technology in a very different way than we do. So have you put it in front of kids yet? Or I'm just curious.
Not yet.
I have some for you.
First of all, thank you very much for being here in Gloucester and doing what you're doing. I think it's just absolutely terrific. Rick and you and the team are doing is just astounding. Thank you. Tom, a question for you, just your opinion on where this may go. I find it fascinating that you can identify a specific fish species by its sound. Do you think the science will allow you to estimate the volume of fish that you're listening to?
That is a research area that's active right now. It's a hard problem because you have to distinguish between one fish chirping twice versus two fish each chirping once. But it is a research area. I think that there is a good chance that you'll be able to use passive acoustics for doing abundance estimation, at least for certain kinds of species. One of the issues, of course, is you have to be close enough to them to hear them. And of course, they don't vocalize all the time. They tend to vocalize when they're spawning times and things like that. But there are research programs now that are trying to, they're trying it with different species and so on. So that's one of the things that we looked at was, is this an alternative way of estimating population densities of things, fish species? Because obviously that's an open question. There's another approach too, which is, I think there's I forgot the name of the company in Gloucester, but it uses environmental DNA, so you scoop up water and you analyze the DNA in that.
That's so far, it's just an idea.
Well, there's actually a company that's exploring.
Well, yes.
So it hasn't panned out yet, that's right. But, the idea of being able to estimate what's there on the basis of bits of DNA that are floating around.
We've been told that you can demonstrate the capability to detect the presence of a certain type of fish based on their vocalization. That would be huge. Yeah. So one of the experiments would be taking a device and scientists have some idea where fish spawn on average and to drop it off in these areas and see if we can pick things up to detect the presence of, say, cod spawning. So that would be the next
step. Rather than doing it with active pinging, and
right.
But the Navy must have a lot of classified methods to use, probably not to detect fish, but same idea.
We would take those sonograms and use that as a basis of like a machine learning algorithm that would take the audio from an aquam pod and detect, come up with some kind of scoring. And I mean, that's what we do. That's, instead of detecting, vehicles and overhead imagery, we're going to try to detect fish and hydrophone data. It's the same hammer, just a slightly different nail.
So if I can just, I want to take the opportunity to answer Mark Lowe's question and then ask a question of this group. So Maritime Gloucester is interested in and has been working with Gloucester Innovations for a while for a couple of reasons. So one is the opportunity to provide education to children, and we've offered a summer ORV class and a number of other sort of marine science classes. Certainly we see the opportunities here to develop educational classes and programs around learning about and really making things using this stuff and this technology. That's, I think, number one. Number two is, and I think you got a sense of this from in part these guys' inspiration, is this, in our mind, has the opportunity to really revolutionize citizen science as it relates to the ocean, to put in people's hands relatively inexpensive ocean monitoring devices to be able to evaluate the health of our oceans on a wide variety of issues. And so we'd love to be a part of that. So the question for you guys is, and no commitments need to be made, is if we offered really an adult workshop, although I'm not sure we would put exactly age limitations on it, and you were to come here to pay some basically supply cost, and I don't know that it would be $500, but probably a couple $100. I mean, would you be interested in a workshop where you'd come and make something? And hands, just to get a sense. Okay. And then certainly in the game plan, something that we hope to be offering in the next, you know, number of months is to really get our hands wet, no pun intended. And the other part of it is we have this extraordinary campus, and when we come out of this cleanup project in 2017, you know, we have a demonstration area and a Harvard classroom right out there that is just ideal to be playing with these cool machines.
Yeah, I think, Tom, I agree with you, having community build things is a terrific idea. But also, as a lure to people outside of Gloucester, have the cameras downloaded to screens here.
Right.
And so that people visiting Maritime Gloucester would see stuff that they'd never see anywhere else. I think that'd be very cool.
Maybe have an exhibit or something.
Yeah, yeah.
So, are you in the process of or thinking of like a hookup with that fisherman? Like I imagine each of those lobster traps has a can, right? You got each of those, and so you get this complete picture of what's going on. And you've got these people who are going out every day, maintaining them, and you know they're getting a sense of maybe their money in a different way from their own experience of what's going on down there and such. And other fishery. Have you guys started hooking up with?
So we had an initial conversation with Mark Ring, Gloucester Lobsterman, who's head of the Gloucester Fisheries Commission, and Al Catone, and was Vito? Was it? Serki Sor. And just to talk about what are your needs? What are your needs for monitoring your environment and what might help you and sort of give them a sense for this. And it was, you know, I would describe it as a healthy, fruitful first conversation that didn't necessarily lead to an absolute next step, but certainly they are interested in anything that can help them be better lobstermen or fishermen. And so it was a good conversation, but that's sort of it for now. Is that a fair description? So we can give a round of applause.